we begin worship, we're going to open with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we just want to thank you for this beautiful weather we've had the past couple days, for the sun to bring out your glory, and with the rain that we've had recently to make everything green and new. And just like you rose last week from the grave, all of our flowers and trees are budding with new life. We just thank you for that, Lord, and be with us this today. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. I should start off with a joke, but I don't want people to leave, so I will get right into things. So, announcements. So we have the AW Spring Refresh Conference. That'll be happening in Auburn. That's coming up here. Looks like the end. Oh, next week, actually. Looks like the weekend on April 21st, 22nd. For more information for registering, get a hold of Christy Christ, or in the you can go to this website that's listed here inside your bulletin. And then the 2023 Great Commission Day offering, that'll be coming up here shortly. More information on the bulletin for that, and we're going to have someone speak to that a little later today. Something the elders have been talking about and looking at is something in your bulletin, a missions trip. Work team is being formed to provide the church community in March, or in Marsh Harbor in the Bahamas. Who doesn't want to go to the Bahamas? Who doesn't want to go in July or August? Oh, I got one person doesn't want to go in August. Okay. Anyhow, they were devastated by Hurricane Doreen that happened back in 2019. So that was, what, three years ago. Still struggling for that. There is going to be information on the missions table, and then a planning meeting is scheduled for May 7th, so more information will follow about that. I Love My Church Work Day, May 20th, we're scheduling another semi-annual church work, or biannual church work day, where twice a year we get together for a couple hours, we have some amazing food. Kelly has already agreed to make a hearty breakfast, so always excited for that. I'll never forget the French toast eating competition between, I think it was Dave Jaros and Todd Wolf. I forgot who won, but I bet Steve could probably beat all of them. He had 16 pancakes one year. That's a record. Anyway, we have a lot of fun. It's a couple hours in the morning. There's painting projects, some lighting, possibly some other work that we're going to get done in the teen room to get that up and running. Good time for fun and fellowship and anyone who knows me knows that I don't know how to do electrical work, but I've done some electrical work here, and things are still working, or so I've been told. So anyway, that's shocking, he says. All right. So there's a couple other things in your bulletin. Next Sunday after the service, we're going to have a Strawberry Festival planning meeting. It's open to anyone with suggestions, ideas. Just come on forward, or come on. We'll probably meet in the front of the sanctuary here just to discuss what we're doing this year. And, we're still looking for ideas. It's early, even though it'll be a few months. And if it's cold this year, we're going to do hot cocoa. So, yes, and free hot cocoa. All righty. And if there's a few other things in your bulletin, and I trust that you'll look over those. At this time, I'm going to ask Robert Church to come up, and he's going to talk about his trip to OCC, or Operation Christmas Child, in Florida. Not the Bahamas.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
First of all, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for giving me the opportunity to go to that trip. It was amazing. Great weather, great messages during the conference. I was picking on people saying that I could be up here for an hour talking about this trip, and they got scared. So all I'm going to do for now, I'm going to have a video play, and then I'm going to talk a few details about a couple things. So go ahead and play the video. Change of plans, I guess. So we'll do a little talking first. So the biggest thing they talked about was this Greatest Journey book that they used for discipleship. The first 3 years when they started, this was the 30th anniversary of, this year's 30th anniversary of Operation Christmas Child. In the first 3 years, it did not involve any discipleship at all. And when they talked about closing it and just totally getting rid of the whole program, but Franklin Graham decided to put some kind of discipleship program into the mix. And ever since then, it's been going strong. The only reason they were closing it because they were running out of money. And ever since he started with this discipleship program, they've never had any problem with any money coming in to support this. Talking about the Great Commission, the Greatest Journey, right now there is over 90 different languages that it's printed in. Some of the books are printed mass over here in the United States, but because of paper supply right now, some of them are actually being printed in their own countries where they can get it done and save money with shipping. They say the first couple of months after collection, they're using like 1,400 containers every month shipping stuff over the different places, countries. These containers that were blacklogged on in the oceans there, those on the ships. So this year, the goal is to have over 4.5 million kids go through the discipleship program with the Greatest Journey. Over 200,000 teachers have been trained since this all started. I thought I wrote down, I don't have the date, when I think it was 97 is when they first started Greatest Journey. Before that, some of you may have known, but I didn't. There was a mailing program that they did. They used to mail out discipleship books and stuff to kids. I never knew that. So this year, 2004, there was 28 teams. Active teams with doing the collection and coordinators and everything. This year, this past year, there was 516 area teams with almost nearly 10,000 Connect volunteers. So this thing has just grown in leaps and bounds in 30 years. So can we get that video now?
Welcome, everyone, to the Samaritan's Purse 2023 Global Connect Conference. At the first Connect Conference in 2007, we had 45 volunteers. Now, look here where we are.
What a celebration of the body of Christ being together.
You can't do the calling that's on you unless you obey your first calling, which is to be with Jesus.
We have thousands of people gathered together with the same calling to share the gospel with the platform of the shoebox gift. And with more than 100 countries represented, we truly are reaching the ends of the earth.
This is about lifting up the name of the Lord Jesus Christ from one end of this earth to the other, one box at a time.
Operation Christmas Child is all about God. This is God's plan, God has done it, and we give Him the praise and glory, and we're celebrating 200 million shoeboxes.
You know, just thinking about it is mind-blowing. 200 million children reached by the gospel of Jesus Christ.
When we're all in one room, the unity is really palpable.
You get to see how Operation Christmas Child works domestically, but also internationally.
The heroes on this end who are packing gift boxes, and they are also excited to meet us who are working internationally and distributing the gift. For me, who have receive a shoebox. This is really special. It is a coming together of one big family.
We have so much to see and experience here at Global. We even have a virtual reality experience.
I caught myself wanting to wave to one of the persons, almost forgetting that it's a virtual experience, but that's how realistic it was.
What I love about Operation Christmas Child is I get to fulfill the Great Commission in a tangible, practical way, and you couldn't be in a more rewarding and fulfilling ministry than Operation Christmas Child.
God tells us to go and tell the things that we have seen, to tell the things that we have heard, and that's what we're gonna do tonight. We are gonna celebrate what He has done through Operation Christmas Child, 200 million boxes in 30 years.
Leading worship at Global Connect. It's too sweet, man. Kind of remind me a little bit of heaven, honestly. I think that's what it's going to be like.
Standing next to one of my heroes, Michael W. Smith, and singing with him was a dream come true. It's such an honor to be a part of what God's doing through Operation Christmas Child.
Every box can make a difference. We got opportunities to take the gospel to children around the world.
112 nations, all 50 states, all these joyful volunteers at Global Connect 2023. What an amazing event.
That was just a glimpse. It was amazing. So this year they decided that the key verse for Operation Christmas Child this year, it's something you probably all heard. It's a common verse for missionaries and stuff, but Acts 1:8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So over 200 million boxes, guys. You know what? That's your guys' fault, but we thank you for that. 30 weeks until collection week, guys. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. As we were watching the video there, I was trying to see if we could see you in the crowd. You were somewhere, but I couldn't see you. At this time, I'd like to ask Dave Jaros to come up and talk about Great Commission. And then after Dave is done, we're gonna turn it over to Mike for some praise and worship. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. At Alliance Council 2023 this spring, 50 international commercial workers will be commissioned to go to some of the last remaining hard places on Earth. Five of these workers will be joining a veteran worker team in the Middle Eastern city where there are at least 50 known believers among the 1.5 million ethnic majority. We can help launch their presence through a gift on the 2023 Great Commission Day offering. We'll be taking this offering between April 16th and the 30th. That's this week and then next two Sundays, where we can come together in prayer and giving so that our Alliance workers will be fully empowered and equipped to bring the good news to places where Jesus' name has yet to be proclaimed. So please just take a minute on your envelopes and you can make the words launch on there. So between Rob and I, we can distinguish and get those to go properly. Thank you.
Let's all stand and we'll sing together.
These are the days of your servant. I pray Praise the Lord. Glory to God in the highest. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. His presence is in this place. Hallelujah. I'm just so excited. I was reminded this morning, this is Missionary Sunday, and we're going to pray as a family and break up into groups. But I was reminded this morning how prayers in the inner chamber are so important, but so is united prayer together, and that's what we're going to do today. And I just was really convicted of that this morning, that we need to be praying together as well as praying and in fellowship and intimate relationship with Jesus in our inner chamber. For our family prayer time today, there are inserts in your bulletin. And it says Lakeview Family Prayers. And these are going to be used as your guide to pray as you gather together to pray today. And Michael said today that there's also going to be a video up here for those at home that are watching at home. And you can also use the call to prayer. There are prayers and testimonies on each side of that that you can use to prompt you for praying as well. So the first two paragraphs in this Lakeview Family Prayers says, anytime you ask an international worker, an IW, I'd still like to call them missionaries, I don't know, what they want or need in their work, prayer is at or near the top of their list. We at Lakeview Chapel faithfully support our RWs with generous financial gifts, and we desire to fortify that with faithful prayer support as well. Use this list of requests from our RWs or other specific requests you are aware of to guide your prayers for God's work around the world. Trust Him to provide for the needs of our RWs, IWs, have while proclaiming the good news of Jesus to a lost world. So break up into groups, maybe somebody behind you or next to you, and use these to prompt you as you pray for missionaries.
Thank you.
It's a beautiful sound to hear the concert of prayer going up to our Heavenly Father. And so I thank you so much for praying, and so do our missionaries and international workers. I thought it was appropriate that Robert shared about Operation Christmas Child. I just wanted to read, and this is a great magazine too, I just want to say, The Alliance Life. And I just want to read a little testimony from Uruguay, and it's about children and the mission field. He doesn't want it to end yet. It's this little boy, said one father when he came to get his son on the last night of our team's kids club. The boy had tears streaming down his face, his mom told me. He never engages in other activities. This is the only one he loves. On Thursdays, he wakes up happy, energized, because he knows this day is kids club. I think he enjoys it so much because he can be himself, and you just accept him for who is and don't try to change him. Thank you for your prayers for Alliance Ministries like this one. The prayers of people like you brought this boy closer to Jesus as he experienced the Father's agape love. Recently, a large group of sixth graders graduated from Kids Club. We are hoping to transition them to youth group, which will have a more spiritual focus. Please pray they will be excited to participate in the activities that, as a result, they and their families will choose to follow Jesus. I'd like to read to you Luke 10:2, which is kind of a familiar scripture. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. So let us pray. We welcome your presence, O Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we have this blessed opportunity to lift up your international workers in prayer. Help us to continue to be faithful to lift up their needs and concerns to your throne room of grace and mercy as they carry out the good news of the gospel to many people groups and nations all over the world. You, O Lord, are their light, their salvation, and refuge. Protect them from the enemy's attacks and keep them steadfast with your strength and peace for the days ahead. When the powers of darkness try to overwhelm them or their ministry, may the word of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, and the testimony of Jesus bring deliverance and salvation. As our workers minister in Ukraine with aid and food, may they have many opportunities to share the gospel of Jesus as many families continue to suffer from ongoing conflict. Oh Lord, we just thank you for all the prayers that have gone up to you, Lord. We give you praise, honor, and glory. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. We pray these things in your name, O Lord, and let us rejoice in the fact that there will be a soul harvest that no man can count of every tribe, tongue, and nation. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
So probably a lot of you are aware, Pastor Dave and Brenda are away with their family on vacation this last week, and they'll be coming back. But that means we get to have a special speaker with us this morning, and we welcome Robert Heinrich from Common Ground. If you have noticed down in Owego, that direction, you know, out towards Tioga Center, the building, before you get to Price Chopper, the building there. And that's where Heinrich, Robert is director there, or, okay. And maybe you'll tell us about a little about that. So, okay, so welcome, come on up, and we're glad to have you with us.
Ah, thank you, Mike. Thank you. Whoa, looks a lot bigger from up here. When I first started delivering messages 30-some years ago, it was in the Catholic Church, and in the Catholic Church, we call these things homilies. But everybody else calls them sermons. So I figured this is kind of a cross between a homily and a sermon. And so we tried to work that out, and Herman didn't really get it. So what I'd like to share with you this morning is a sermile. Is that what he said? Sermile? Yeah. The night before he died, Jesus was gathered with his flock, with his little children, as he called them. And he tried to love them and comfort them and prepare them for what was going to happen the next day. And then he turned to the Father and he prayed for them. And Jesus' prayer we can find in the 17th chapter of the Gospel according to John. And Jesus said to the Father, while I was here, I protected them in your name. And then he continued, beginning with verse 13. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world so that they may have my joy completed in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And I sanctify myself for their sakes, so that they also may be sanctified in truth. Being in the world, sent into the world, on mission into the world, but not being of it, we know that's not easy. How do you walk through the world and not at some point or other get it kind of to stick to you, or you get attached to it, or you begin belonging to the world in just a little way? And over the centuries, we as church have gotten it about as wrong as we can in every possible way we could get it wrong. But each time we get it wrong, our mission is compromised just a little bit. Our message is diminished just a little bit. But there is one way that we've gotten it wrong that destroys, undermines our mission, and it turns what comes out of our mouth from the truth to a lie. To show you what I mean, I'd like to tell you a story this morning about three Christians. We start in England in the early 1600s. At that time, the King of England was also the head of the church. But those were Reformation times. It was just a little bit more than 100. You're around 100 years since Martin Luther's 95 Theses. And people were beginning to read the scripture for themselves. They were beginning to listen to God for themselves. They were finding that still, small voice in their conscience, and they were following that, which often then put them at odds with the English church. And of course, if you're at odds with the English church, you're at odds with the king. That doesn't make for a very happy life. So many, many people decided to set sail for the new England and religious freedom. Obadiah Holmes was one of those, and he arrived in Boston in 1638, and he settled in Salem in Massachusetts Bay Colony, and he joined the church there. Notice I say the church there. It wasn't one on every corner. There was the church that the Puritans established when they had founded the colonies of Massachusetts Bay, Rhode Island, and New Haven not too many years prior. And it was to be the only church. The governor once found out that there were some people in Massachusetts Bay that were thinking about starting another church, so he sent them back to England. So Obadiah Holmes joined the church. But being a man of conscience, he found himself often disagreeing with the pastor, finding himself in discussions, arguments that got him no place. So Obadiah and a few of his friends decided simply to meet in their homes on the Lord's Day and worship the Lord, which got Obadiah Holmes indicted. Because meeting from house to house privately on the Lord's Day was contrary to the order of the court. See, Massachusetts Bay, Rhode Island, and New Haven were all established by the Puritans as what they called biblical commonwealths. We would say theocracies. So that the law of God became the law of the land. The law of God as the Puritans understood it. So under indictment, Obadiah moved to Newport in the Rhode Island colony, where things were a little bit more tolerant. And his little group grew, and they eventually came to be known as Baptists. Now, in 1651, Obadiah and two other members of his little group decided to go visit a friend named William in the town of Lynn back in Massachusetts Bay Colony. And while they were gathered with William in his home, constables entered and arrested Obadiah and his friends. They were tried and they were convicted of meeting house to house on the Lord's Day. And they were sentenced to pay fines. Now, friends of the other two members that were with Obadiah, they paid the fines on behalf of their friends. But Obadiah refused to pay the fine, and he forbade his friends from paying the fine for him. So Obadiah received the alternate punishment. He was to be whipped. And so on September 5th, 1651, Obadiah Holmes was led out and tied to the whipping post, which, interestingly, was located immediately outside the First Church in Boston. He was stripped to the waist, and he was administered 30 lashes, which, according to witnesses, were laid on with extreme and particular savagery. Afterward, Obadiah said, "Ye have struck me as with roses." And I pray to God that this sin not be held against you. Now, about 5 years later, Cromwell was running England, and things there were very bad, particularly for Baptists and Quakers. So around 1656, Quakers began to arrive in Boston in such numbers that the governor became very upset, and hastily ordinances were passed that prohibited Quakers from residing in Massachusetts Bay Colony, and then eventually from even setting foot in Massachusetts Bay Colony. Now, the Quakers saw this as an evil against which they were led to stand. So as quickly as they got expelled from Massachusetts Bay Colony, they went back to Massachusetts Bay Colony, and they got expelled and went back, even as the punishments got worse and worse, until in 1659, two Quakers hung from the Great Elm in Boston College Commons, convicted of the crime of being Quakers in Massachusetts. There was a third person that was supposed to have been hung that day. Her name was Mary Dyer. And when she was halfway up the ladder, leaning against the tree, someone shouted, "Reprieve! Mary, come down!" Well, Mary stood there. She figured, "Lord, if it was your will for me to die for religious freedom, then it's probably against your will for me to come down." So they snatched her off the ladder, stuck her on a horse, shipped her someplace outside of Massachusetts Bay Colony, where she didn't stay very long. And upon her rearrival, the governor himself stood before Mary, pronouncing the sentence of death and offering her one last chance to repent. Mary's response was, "Nay, it is not I who am in need of repentance, but you." And for those who do this out of the simpleness of their hearts, may God forgive them. And so on June 1st, 1660, Mary Dyer hung from the Great Elm in Boston Commons. Now, the man who stood before Mary Dyer on that day was the same person who had passed these ordinances and laws. He was also a member of the court that sentenced Obadiah Holmes. His name was John Endicott, and he was fiercely, intensely a Puritan. And for him, that meant visiting the wrath of God unyieldingly and without mercy on every person whom he found to be a sinner. So here are our three Christians. Obadiah Holmes, convicted basically of being a Baptist, who followed his own conscience and followed Christ to the whipping post. Mary Dyer, in obedience to God, followed Christ even unto death. And John Endicott, who played the role of Pontius Pilate. There can be no other outcome when you try to advance the kingdom using the power of the world than that you will have Christians persecuting Christians. Now, you would think that we learned a lesson from this history. It was very much on the mind of our founding fathers when they passed the First Amendment to our Constitution that said, Congress shall make no law regarding the establishment of any religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. You would think that that would matter. You would think, and you would be justified, that it mattered that nowhere does Jesus ever say, use the power of Caesar to advance the kingdom of God. Jesus didn't say to his disciples when he sent them out, now look, whatever town you come to, find the person who's in power and convert him. And then he'll make everybody else convert. You would think that that would matter. But you know what? We would be wrong. Because today, all over the world, but here in the United States as well, there are those who want to establish another theocracy. There are people in our Congress, sitting on our state legislatures, residents in governor's mansions, pastors of large churches, who wish to make this country what they call a Christian nation by force of law. They present themselves with the title of Christian nationalists, Christian nationalism. But folks, it's not nationalist because it wishes to go directly against the First Amendment, and in some cases, they move to repeal the First Amendment. And it's not Christian because in addition to all the scriptural evidence against it, is the fact that they would deny human beings the exercise of the most elemental thing that makes us creatures created in the image and likeness of God, and that is our free will. People are led to Jesus. They are loved to Jesus. Their hearts are converted to Jesus. They are not pushed and marched to Jesus at the point of a gun or through the force of a law. And so in this country today, there are those who are already enacting laws, already, that make those who adhere to their understanding of God's law privileged, and make everyone else who finds God's law different than they do outside the law, potentially criminals. So this is the world into which we are sent, every day into which we are sent. And we need the protection of the Father that Jesus prayed for. And we need Jesus walking by our side. And we need the Holy Spirit in our hearts to do that. And as Jesus prayed, we need to be sanctified in the truth so that we can be, as Jesus told his disciples, we can be wise as serpents. I really never understood what that meant, and I don't like serpents much, but now I do, because we need to be so imbued in the truth that we can recognize the wolf who comes not only in sheep's clothing, but in the clothing of the lamb. As Paul put it, we must no longer be children, tossed to and fro blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness with deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in love, we must grow in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ. Speaking the truth in love. There's a Christian Missionary Alliance document that came out in 2015 called Staying on Mission. And I think it expressed it for me, what that means to us today. First of all, it said, this world is no more in need of love without truth than it is in need of truth without love. And then it said that our response to an unrepentant sinner should be love, grace, and truth. Think about that. Love, grace, and truth. If we can manage to navigate through this world, engaged with it as Christ was engaged with it, in love, grace, and truth, then we can come to the end of our life's journey and look back on the path we walked and see flowers of the kingdom sprouting from the seeds that we planted. Our mission accomplished. The message, the good news of the kingdom proclaimed, delivered, clear, and true.
This song that we'll sing brings to mind the situation where Daniel's friends stood for what was right, what they understood God to be calling them to do, and were faced with consequences of that, and Moses leading the people out of Egypt and then being at the edge of the Red Sea and being chased, following God, but has this difficulty in front of them. And to see God's deliverance in all of that. There's another in the fire. Let's all stand as we sing and pray that we'll see God's deliverance as we follow Him in our lives, in our communities, with those that that we rub shoulders with.
There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need remorse, reminding of how I've been set free. There is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire. Longer a slave to my sin anymore. And should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning, either way I won't bow to the things of this world. And I know I will never be alone. There is another in the fire standing to me. There's another in the waters holding back the sea. And should I ever need reminding what power set me free? There is a grave that holds no body, and now that power lives in me. There is another in the fire. There's another in the fire. Oh, there's another in the fire. Oh, there's another in the fire. Oh, and I can see the light in the darkness as the darkness bows to him. I can hear the roar in the heavens as the space between wears thin. I can feel the ground shake beneath us as the prison gates cave in. Nothing stands between us. Nothing stands between the name that is Jesus. He who was and still is and will be through it all. So come what may in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning. I know I will never be another in the fire standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding how good you've been to me, I'll count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. And I can see the light in the darkness, as the darkness bows to him. I can hear the roar in the heavens, as the space between wears thin. I can feel the ground shake beneath us, as the prison walls cave in. Nothing stands between us. Nothing stands between us. There'll be another in the fire standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding how good you've been to me, I'll count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. I'll count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. Count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. I'll count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. I'll count count the joy, come every battle, because I know that's where you'll be.
Sorry.
It's been my pleasure and my honor to be with you this morning. I'd like to close with actually a verse from a song written by Michael Card called Barakah. And it's based on a passage from the book of Numbers, chapter 6. Lord bless you and keep you. Lord would make his face shine upon you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace.